My name is John Farquharson. I'm a director with the Sewage Treatment Action Group, and I'm also a member of the Right Plan Coalition. Thanks for coming out tonight for a presentation on wastewater treatment. Like me, you may have heard quite a few over the past 3 or 4 years. But this one's going to be different. Yes, Ed Clerico is a professional engineer, but more importantly, he's an expert on water reuse and sustainable infrastructure. He's at the forefront of water energy innovation. Through over 30 years of experience in water resource and waste management, he's gained a deep understanding of the related economic and social issues. He's the founder of Applied Water Management, which is now a subsidiary of Natural Systems Utilities, which is headquartered in Hillsboro, New Jersey. Natural Systems owns and operates the largest base of decentralized sustainable infrastructure in the United States, with over 200 systems across North America. Ed presently serves as an advisor to its executive and management team. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Ed Clerico.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming out. It's great to see such a good, strong interest in the topic of wastewater. I mean, it's obviously it's important to people, and that's really nice to see. I don't always go places and find this much interest, so that's great. And it's my first time to the Victoria, Vancouver region, and it's really a pleasure to be here. What a beautiful place you all live in, and it's wonderful to learn about your water resources. As was said in the introduction, I'm an engineer. Don't hold that against me. I'm also a wastewater operator, and been in the business for 30 plus years. And started in the decentralized aspect at the very outset, almost, not at the very outset. Started doing regional plants when I first came out of college. My background was agricultural engineering, which they rebranded as the bioresource engineering because there wasn't a lot of agriculture work in New Jersey at the time. And so it was a great entree into the environmental world back in the 70s because everyone else was a civil engineer, and I had a little bit different perspective on things relative to the environment and how biological systems work, which is something I'm going to make a part of my discussion this evening. So a couple of things I'm going to tell you a little bit about me and how I got here, and I'm sure there's a whole story to why all you people would take a Thursday night to come out and sit and listen to a lecture about wastewater. So we obviously have something in common. And it's become very evident to me that as you learn and you understand things, all of a sudden things crystallize and you get a recognition of how things can be possible. And I love this quote by Jane Goodall about, until we understand, you know, only if we understand what we care, and only when we care can we help, and only if we'll help will we be saved. Well, the benefit I get and why I get so excited about my work is I think it has been a struggle over all the years. This has not been an easy task doing what we've done. But I think we've really made a difference and we've progressed to the point that I'm starting to see the world change in terms of how we address water, and we're very happy to have some of our projects as kind of examples of what the future might look like. I also put this quote from Elton John up there, not that it has anything to do with my work directly, but it is because agriculture and farming were a really important part of my background and kind of brought me to where I started off in my career, and became, as I went on in life, more evident that it was an important part of why I was doing things the way I was doing things with wastewater and water that others were not. So a couple of things. I'm going to talk a little bit about myself and some of the philosophical things. I'm going to get into a little bit of the technology and some references on projects. But I first want to start off with just a little bit of an update of what's happening in my world from a regulatory standpoint. And there's a huge shift, finally, in America. And actually, Canada has a really big role in it. I'll explain that to you. Around resilience in water and all the aspects of resilience, from resilience of supply to resilience in terms of the environment and what we do with how we manage our resource in total. And there's a group, the National Water Research Institute, and Environmental Research Foundation, collaborating to develop the first ever guidelines for non-potable water use in the world for residential, in-home, in-business use of non-potable water. That's really big because it establishes now a formal set of guidelines that we think are now going to become regulations in California around the whole subject of non-potable water. So we have the potable water regulations telling us how to safely use potable water for consumption. We have the clean water regulations. I'm talking about in the states now. I think your regulations here are similar. They might be named differently. Clean water regulations, which are about our wastewater. And there was this big gray area in between that was undefined between what was potable and what was considered wastewater. And for many years, all the work we did was difficult to regulators because there was no real regulation to guide it. Because what were we? Were we water supply or were we wastewater disposal? And how do you define the two? Well, this effort now is going to establish much more certainty around that. So these guidelines will be coming out in the next week or two. It's about a year-long effort. And you can see some of the entities that rallied around this that were participants in this stakeholders group to sign on to embracing this combination of public utility managers and public health officials from around the world. And notice, please, the province of Alberta is in there because the University of Alberta, Nick Ashbolt, is heading up a program there. And he's been very active, first in the States as working for the EPA, now up here in Canada, in guiding a lot of the risk management aspects of the public health concerns around water reuse. So this NWRI initiative is going to end up defining ways to reuse water in all its different ways. But it's not looking at just wastewater. It's looking at any source of water that might make for alternative supply, because as you travel around the world, the opportunities vary depending on the environment of where you are. So it's rainwater from catchments, from roofs, stormwater runoff from surfaces, condensate water, shallow groundwater, meaning near the surface from foundation drains or shallow unscreened wells, wastewater, and gray water as sources of supply. Well, in the past, they were always considered essentially problems to be managed. And now the world's turning around and they're being looked at formally from a regulatory standpoint as a resource, which changes many things. And the non-potable uses that are essentially considered standard now are toilet flushing, which is something we've been doing for the longest time, laundry, cooling, irrigation, and a washdown. And irrigation really was the first water reuse play in America. It was important in California many, many years ago. And they adopted a regulation, it was the first of its kind, called Title 22, which was a regulation designed to provide a healthy way of taking wastewater, effluent, and using it on agricultural crops that were for consumption, for human consumption. So they drafted these regulations. They became the guiding standard that everyone then followed beyond that. But it was written as a wastewater management tool more than it was as water supply. And so that's now changing. So now, a little bit about me, and I turn back to my background on the farm with the bovine perspective on water resource management, because when I was a kid, I lived on this dairy farm, and I was the youngest of my brothers, and when I was young and I was not old enough to work, my pastime and my play, a lot of time was spent in this lovely little stream called the Royce Brook, and I learned a lot about water by playing in the water, and it happened to have really nice clay formations there and sand, and you could build all sorts of things, and it was great. But it would never fail when they had the opportunity, the cows would meander into the stream, and sure enough, as soon as they got in the stream, you know what they would do. And that always really pissed me off. And it was my first opportunity to work on wastewater treatment, because here I could build all these things to try to get the cow poop out of the screen. Well, it wasn't those cows, because these are beef cows, and this is back in the day when we had dairy animals. And so that launched my kind of recognition into wastewater management, and it just struck me very vividly at that time, well, stupid animals, they crap in the water they drink, you know? What a dumb thing to do, because I knew at our home, we had a septic system, and of course, being practical people that you are on a farm, you clean your septic system out yourself. So I knew a lot about how the septic system worked, and it was really important to have it working well. and that water was filtered down into the ground. So I always thought we were light years ahead of the cows until I went to college and started studying wastewater systems. And then I recognized that, holy geez, we're doing the same thing the cows are doing. And here I had to go to school all these years to figure that out. Well, there was another big aha moment for me to do with when my wife wanted to renovate a bathroom that absolutely didn't need to be renovated. Because there was nothing wrong with this bathroom. Everything worked just fine. And well, in terms of discussing what we're going to do once I broke down, I said, okay, you're going to renovate the bathroom. But if we're going to renovate the bathroom, I want to at least put in a dual flush toilet. And she looks at me, she says, why would you want to do that? The one we have to flush it twice. I said, no. Dual flush doesn't mean flush twice. It means you have a choice between whether you want to use a lot of water or use a little bit of water, depending on whether it's a number one or a number two. And so we had a good chuckle about that. She said, okay, you could have your dual flush toilet. And then the idea came up of having a choice. Because one of the problems I recognize as an engineer is we have very, very little choice with regards to our infrastructure and our resources, because we're used to somebody providing all the service to it, and we just use it. I've been amazed over the years at how little people understand what happens to their water and where it comes from, where it goes, what the impacts are. Most people are absolutely clueless about it. So we talked about the idea of having a choice of flushing your toilet with number one or number two. At least that would give people a decision they can make. And we had a laugh, and I said, well, what if we gave them the opportunity to flush the toilet with bottled water instead of tap water? How nice would that be? How American would that be? And we laughed, and we said, we ought to buy some Leisure Time water, because you always go in there. You know what you do. So I said, all right. So I bought a Leisure Time water bottle, and I secured it to my tank so our guests could flush with Leisure Time water, they could flush with public supplied water. Well, obviously, that's not a functional toilet, but you get the idea. And once you start thinking about it, it really drives home again. Why do we go through all the trouble to protect our water resources, to make them to the extent that you could bottle them, and many times we do, and then we put them in our toilet and we use them to defecate in? That was an aha moment for me as we were starting to work on water reuse, why it was a really important shift in how we manage infrastructure. Another one for me is around perception and perspectives. As I grew up and got older and struggled with trying to understand why people just couldn't see the value in what we were doing, when the internet started, I had this interesting endeavor. And yes, I remember days before the internet. I imagine other people here do too. And I had the opportunity to work all over the world. I've been in the Mideast and dealt with issues in South America. And everywhere you go, the water resource issues are different, but people carry a very high value of water. They know it's vital for life. It has religious connotations to it. People believe water is generally abundant in the world, maybe not exactly where they live. And they all know it can be humanely influenced. Like somebody affects whether you're at an oasis in the desert and somebody's managing that water, or whether you're in a place where water is abundant. They know that we have a role in it, but they don't really understand what choices and roles we could have. And people have these perceptions around wastewater that it's taboo, it's dirty, it's dangerous, and it's kind of like a necessary evil. It's what you don't talk about. And I see in that dynamic a lot of the issues of the struggle, that people just didn't want to have open, honest conversations about these things because it was something that was just, you don't talk about that. You know, somebody else handles it. And that established for me a perception. And so I did some sailing for a while, and I know this picture, when I used the internet and I found this picture of the globe, I had to have it oriented in this direction because all of my slides had, I'm an East Coast person originally, had the ocean on the right and the land on the left. And I was doing a lecture in California. I said, my God, the people are going to know I'm from New Jersey. So what could I do? I'm not going to redo all my slides. So I flipped it over and I was looking at it and going, you know, it's amazing. I can't find anything on that map when I flip it over. And that really, really puzzled me. And then I started thinking about that. And why is north up? And I don't know whether you could find Victoria easily on the map. It took me some time, but hey, it's my first time in Victoria, so I had to go study Google Earth a little bit. But as soon as you flip it over, I could find my home in like 1 second, no problem. I didn't have to think about anything. So I got the starting a search on the internet for why is north up? Because it just puzzled me. Because as an engineer, legally, if I go to a public hearing and I display a map, I have to display it with north being up so that people don't get confused about where I'm putting that wastewater treatment plant. They might think, oh, that's far from where I live. That's on the other side of town. But I might have the map upside down. And they might come to learn later it was next door. And that's not legal. I can't do that. So north, it has to be up legally. So I started an internet search of people, well, why is north up? Is there some scientific reason? Is there some other reason? Well, after a really good series of emails, a history professor at a university in Hawaii came back to me and said, no, there's absolutely no reason why north is up other than for the fact that the first map ever made was made by this Greek philosopher Anaximander, and he drew his map with Greece on the top and everybody else below it, so go figure. If you were going to draw the first map, you'd probably put yourself on top too. And that became, as far as they could tell, the first true map defining like geographic positioning of cultures and societies next to each other. And so the maps have always been drawn with the sun coming up on the right and going down on the left and north being up, and that became a standard that we just adapted to, and that became common, and we all understood that. So now I knew that I was always just holding maps right side up so that it was because of an Anaximander. And how major a thing that is based on just somebody doing something one way, one time. And of course, in today's world, given our spatial dynamics and what we understand about the universe, north being up is kind of totally irrelevant to anything, really. And as I think about that, and I think about my business and the people I meet and the people I work with, and they're all wonderful people and all really care about what they do, they all bring different perceptions, I realize that all the innovation I was working on and people were doing was all based on just taking the model of the original infrastructure that the Romans created and tweaking it. It wasn't really all that innovative. The Romans, and it wasn't just the Romans, it was the Mesopotamians and people around that era that advanced these concepts, but we give the Romans a lot of credit because they did some really beautiful stuff. They were really smart engineers and they had really cheap labor that they could do this, and they created some of the most wonderful examples of aqueducts and sewers, some of the first sewers in the world. And they had a goddess, Cloacina, that carried the waste out to the river. And from that point on, they were the first ones to initiate this linear system of you take pure water and resources in from upstream, you put it into this sewer, as you flush your sewer, and it goes downstream and all is good. And in essence, that's essentially what we do today. And as I look around at various situations, the Ohio River is a great example. There's 27 major cities on the Ohio River when you start at Pittsburgh and before you get to the Mississippi River. And they say in a drought period, a 7-day, 10-year low flow period, 50% of the Ohio River has been through somebody's plumbing. And that's a water supply for everybody along the river. So as I was speaking about water reuse, and people go, oh, we can't have water reuse. No, that would be unsafe and whatnot. I think, do you realize what we're doing? Because people have this perception that every time you take water upstream, it's pristine. It hasn't been touched by anything or anybody, and it's hundreds of years at least before anything's touched it. Well, no, not in the Ohio River anyhow. Many places where you go, it's actually relatively recently been used, and you're using it again. But you're doing it unintentionally, and you're doing it without control. So that, to me, is the risk. If we would do it intentionally and do it with the proper controls, it would be a much better outcome. Okay, one more little tidbit of information has to do with what I thought was one of the best kind of comical explanations of this. If you've never been to see the story of stuff, there's this wonderful comical review of everything I'm telling you done much better than I do around this whole idea of everything we use, that we use in a linear manner, and that we really think we can just keep taking resources and using them and disposing of them, and that's going to be okay in the long term. That's okay. So I recommend, if you haven't ever seen this, go see it. It's about 10 minutes long, and you'll get a good chuckle. But I use that because as we've done reuse work, water reuse first, of course, solid waste reuse in my community is just massive. You would never put something recyclable out with your garbage, and every neighbor kind of like looks to see who's got the biggest pile of recyclables. And it's gotten to the point where, you know, we recycle so much, I really almost don't need the solid waste container anywhere near as much as we used to. We could almost not quite do away with it, but we could get it every once every 2 weeks. And this idea of water stuff and stuff and food, by reusing it, you're not just reusing the resource, you're conserving energy, you're reducing pollution, you're accomplishing a lot of things at once that make it more sustainable. So I'm going to talk about that in some of the models I'm going to talk about in a minute. So in terms of my background, this recognition came to me through some good fortune in 1985. My office is not too far from Princeton, and we have a lot of pharmaceutical companies in New Jersey, and Squibb Pharmaceutical was building a new facility in Princeton. They had a new product line coming out, and they bought a piece of property, had all their zoning approvals, and they were going to build this factory to manufacture this product, and the real estate department didn't realize there were no sewers on that project property. And because the sewers were right down the street, they thought, well, that's not a problem, I'll just extend the sewers up to this property, not recognizing that building sewers and extending sewers can sometimes be a very controversial, very political, very complicated endeavor, even when they exist and you just want to extend them. So they found out the unfortunate news, they couldn't extend their sewer. And they had a product that had to come out to market, which was, I'm sure, worth a gazillion dollars. And so the cost of solving this problem became insignificant. So we were fortunately had a good reputation out here. We got hired. They said, somehow, solve this problem. And they didn't say, you know, cost doesn't matter at all. But we could tell cost really didn't matter. They just wanted it solved in a way that they could get their product out. So we were fortunate. We were in Princeton. The chairman of the Board of Health was a physicist. They had an MD on the Board of Health. And Squibb was a great client. They had scientists on their, you know, development team and whatnot. So you couldn't have a better team of people to think this through. And so we looked at what NASA was doing with the space station. We looked at all sorts of cool stuff. And as an engineer now I'm getting psyched. I'm thinking, okay, this is going to be fun. And so we did the first, for us, membrane bioreactor for water reuse. And we weren't the first one. They had been doing them in Japan already. And so we learned from some models in Tokyo how it was done. We found a couple of outliers in the States, one in Texas and one in Virginia, and found a company that was manufacturing systems that hadn't quite come to market. And so we deployed it. And of course, the regulators struggled because, well, how do you know? All these things, how do you know? How do you know they're going to not shut it off? Well, they can't shut it off because if they shut it off, they can't flush their toilets, and it's not likely they're going to shut it. Not either going to shut it off. Well, they could replumb the building and this and that. And so, this building has 350 employees in it, and to build a groundwater recharge system would take up a lot of land. This is very poor soils. Nowhere is near as good as some of the soils we saw today, and as we toured around, it would have taken acres of land. But through reuse, because this inside this building they had no showers, no laundry. No on-site food preparation. It was mostly toilet flushing and coffee stations. The water reuse component was really high. It was 95%. So you really were discharging very, very little water. So we got the regulator to agree, look, we'll reserve all this land over here if we ever need it. But we're going to put in this recharge system. It's about the size of a single-family home recharge system. And these 350 people are going to come to work, and everything's going to be fine. And they agreed. And they did, and it was, and it's still there, and it's 25 years old. It's been there forever. It's one of the older style membrane bioreactors. Once we did that, we said, oh my God, this is amazing. Look what you can do. This is going to revolutionize the wastewater industry. Little did I know. It wasn't until 15 years later, we had already built 10 of these before the conversation ever came into a Water Environment Federation conference that people actually, first time it was talked about. And the bigger water, wastewater world started looking at membranes as a possibility. So by then we had built many. We were already probably up to into the year 2000. And these are just examples of schools, stadiums, and then eventually into the year 2000, residential developments in places I never figured as an agriculture engineer be working. We were working in Manhattan, and I figured, why would the people in Manhattan ever want to do water reuse? They've got huge sewers, they've got massive water supply, and they started a sustainable urban development initiative that they were very serious about, and they dedicated this redevelopment area called Battery Park City to demonstrate to the world what could be done better with urban development. So they started doing water reuse systems. And then eventually bigger residential systems, and then eventually one up here in Canada in Wood Buffalo in Alberta for McDonald Island. It's a recreational island they were building. And on and on. As time went on, they got bigger, they got more complicated. I'll talk about these in a little more detail as I go on. So being I'm from New Jersey, our biggest base of business was in New Jersey. There was a big base of business out in the middle of the country in Minnesota, and now on the West Coast and up the East Coast to Boston. So those little green dots are all the little systems that we have. And the reason I like this photo, because you all heard about Superstorm Sandy, it came roaring right through this area. And we did not have one system go down. We did not have one violation on any of those systems. We had a hell of a fire drill because there were problems everywhere, and just keeping emergency generators running was not easy, I wouldn't say that. But when everything came back to normal, we were already there, we were already running. Our customers saw absolutely zero interruption in service. That's by comparison to the regional plants, which were just devastated, and some of them were out of service for up to a month, just discharging raw sewage, or screen sewage at the time, because they got completely inundated with the flood. Well, of course, the benefit here is these are newer systems built up on higher land, and they're distributed. And by being distributed, as I always say, it's a different management model. You don't have one big massive thing to manage, which if it tumbles and it teeters and it goes down, it's one big massive problem to bring it back up. But we have a lot of little systems, and when there is a problem, and there are problems, you'll basically get one or two problems here and there, and they're more manageable. You don't have to go through the massive effort of bringing them back. So this gained attention around the subject of resiliency, because we had gone through a major event and had come through with flying colors. So a couple of case study information. I'm going to talk about Battery Park City a little bit. This is in the lower end of Manhattan. The map on the right shows you the area. It's 90 acres with 20 million square foot of space on it. It's absolutely some of the highest quality buildings I've ever participated in. And the red, the buildings in red are the ones that were built in the later part of the program, and the ones that have the water reuse systems in them. And it probably, not probably, it would have been more efficient if we had built two systems, one up here in the north region and one down here in the south, but that's not where the planners were at that time. They were going development by development, and they were letting the developers decide what they were going to build. So these are all individual water reuse systems. And it's a picture of one. I'm going to show you a video of it in a minute. It's down, they're in the basements of the buildings, and they take the wastewater that comes down the basement, and they catch it, treat it, send it back up for non-potable uses. And this was a major step forward. First, it was residential. It was urban. Just doing water reuse residential was a big shift, because the public health regulator felt it was a more sensitive situation. Whereas in a school or an office building or an institution, there'd be a commercial plumber, you know, there'd be trained people. You wouldn't have the handy-dandy homeowner on the weekend trying to fix something and doing something wrong and connecting to the wrong pipe. So getting to the point where they accepted this was really important, and it was thanks to the leadership of the Giuliani and the Bloomberg administrations that came afterwards. They both had very devoted commitment to seeing things like this through to demonstrate future city growth patterns, and then by having that clear leadership, it really helped all of the agencies below them help figure out ways to solve the problems. So being I can't take you to Manhattan, I'm going to show you a quick video that I think gives you a pretty good sense of what these facilities look like and how they operate. Okay, and this workbook. There you go.
Sorry for the music. We capture all the wastewater in the basement. We treat all that wastewater.
This is a Columbia University class.
For beneficial purpose, either in the form of flush water, cooling tower water, irrigation of the green roof, sidewalk maintenance, and most recently it's gotten approved for laundry as well. And you say, why did they do that? Right? Because Battery Park City Authority said, we're going to do it differently. We're going to require developers that come in here to do it differently. And Albany's, right, Albany's organization developed this building, and they also developed the Solaire, right, which was done in 2003.
Albany's organization is a real estate firm that's been around for about 60 years now. And I guess it was about 15 years ago when we started developing sustainable buildings. What's very important for Albany's organization is that we have a good product Albanese organization is a long-term owner. This was a very important partnership for us. They not only implemented the plan for us, but they maintained it. They monitor the water and make sure that it's run very efficiently.
Integrated water resource management includes having an understanding of the entire water cycle and knowing how this building interacts with its surrounding environment and all forms of water. We're now in the basement of the Visionaire. This 450,000 square foot building, in less than 2,000 square feet in this room, we treat all the wastewater for the building. It all flows above us in this big black pipe and enters into the feed tank. This feed tank is an equalization tank. It holds that raw wastewater until we're ready to process it and as we need it for the reuse purpose. Once it comes into the tank, it'll flow first through this trash basket. The trash basket removes large solids and the rest of the effluent will fall into the tank. Once it's ready to be processed, the feed pumps will actually transfer the wastewater from this tank into our process tanks. Process tanks are both anoxic and aerobic. We'll first go through the anoxic tank into the aerobic tank. The aerobic tank is continuously aerated with diffusers that are on the bottom of the tank. That air provided by these blowers that you see behind you will go into the tank and provide oxygen to the microorganisms that are actually doing the work. After going through the process tanks and removing the nutrients, we then have to filter out the solids. This is a Xenon Z-Weed 500 membrane. Okay, this is a high-end filter which removes the solids. Once the water has been filtered, it'll travel through these white pipes above and come through our disinfection system. Okay, we have three forms of disinfection here at the Visionaire. First is ozone, followed by ultraviolet radiation and sodium hypochlorite. The entire system is controlled by this PLC, or programming logic controller. This will monitor flow rates, it'll monitor all alarm conditions so that we know how the system is operating. In addition to that, we have a turbidity meter. Okay, this turbidity meter will monitor the turbidity continuously. Show you the finished product. So we've taken what was once considered a waste product and we've treated it to a level for beneficial purposes. In doing that, we've reduced our potable water needs by over 50%, and we've reduced our discharge into the sewer by over 60%. Cheers.
My employees are very dedicated. They love what they do. And we don't promote the idea of drinking the water because it's not really treated to potable standards. It's near potable. We don't take the salt out of it. So you would have to do some desalination and salt adjustment if you really wanted to make it. It's a little over 1,000 parts per million in TDS, so it wouldn't meet the potable water standards. But we drink it. I mean, we drink it to prove a point more than anything else. And so do our customers. We tell them not to, but once in a while, they'll, you know, get a little silly. They want to have a taste. So there's a lot to that. I don't want to diminish that, you know, this happened overnight. There's a lot of innovations that became evident over time, and one step at a time, through the application of the membranes, through the advent of better disinfection systems. Through automation. I mean, automation was absolutely key here because you wouldn't be able to do this affordably if somebody had to stand there all day and watch it. So the fact that you have membranes and high dependable unit processes that you can monitor really easily with instrumentation, and now the way computers work so well, we can watch all the 200 systems we have automatically. People are informed instantly if there's something wrong. And actually, they're monitored in an instantaneous, continuous manner that's much superior than what you get in a traditional water plant where somebody takes a grab sample once a day, sends it to a lab, gets results back hours or maybe a day or two later. What good is that information to know what was going on at that moment a day earlier? I mean, it's a whole different level of security, really, as you establish these type systems. And we couldn't do that at one time, but now being able to do that gives you an amazing ability to assure quality control that's pretty unique by comparison to where we were in the past. And these are just some of the examples of these buildings. These buildings all have like 1,000 people in them and more. So they're almost like little communities, and they're still considered decentralized. And some of the concepts I know you're discussing here are decentralized at even a slightly larger scale. The term decentralized kind of gets confused in the business world. What does it mean? Well, it means pretty much everything other than the really big centralized systems. And there's no clear definition. We say neighborhood scale, district scale, on-site, and these are examples of on-site systems because they're all in the basements of the buildings. Well, as time went on, the challenges kept rising because we got to be known as the crazy company that could reuse water and you don't need to hook up to the sewers. And so we would get business a lot of time from developers that had opportunities to develop something. A lot of regional shopping malls use this, some private schools and institutions. And the really fascinating was one was the Gillette Stadium where the New England Patriots play football. There was an NFL stadium there. It was a god-awful place. It was embarrassing what was there, and they were on to build a new one, but they didn't have sewers. They had this old failing wastewater plant, and they were going to leave. This is in a town of Foxborough, Massachusetts. And I don't know how popular American football is up here, but it's to the people in Boston, this is really important. And the team, if they couldn't get what they needed in terms of support from the community and infrastructure, they were going to pack up and leave and go to Hartford, Connecticut. That wasn't going to work. So everyone rallied together to figure out what they could do to keep the team here. And they knew we had done water reuse system at a regional mall. I said, can you do that for the stadium? And so we did. This was in the year 2000. It was a great example because it was built truly as the first like utility scale. It started with 500,000 gallons a day capacity. And it was a really challenging project because if you imagine, the stadium holds 60,000 people during a sporting event. And we learned that when they have music events, they just had Kenny Chesney there 2 weeks ago, 100,000 people. And sometimes they'll have music festivals where there's 100,000 people 2 days in a row. It makes for huge variations in flow and challenges to the operating of the system. But once you know what your design criteria is and you design accordingly, you can accommodate all of this. And you have to accommodate all the beer and everything else that goes into the down the sewers here. And it was a great model for the town because the town of Foxborough wanted the stadium, but they didn't want to send the sewers from Boston out to the region because they knew it would have changed their region so dramatically that they didn't want that. They wanted the economic engine of the stadium and what came with it, but they didn't want the secondary impacts of extending regional sewer. So they got what they wanted. The rest of the town uses wells and septics, and here's the stadium. They carved out this zone that was their commercial development zone. We built the stadium first, and then the system was doubled in size and expanded to pick up all this other development that came around it, which is a combination of entertainment, hospitality, retail, food service, and healthcare. And the place has just turned into a destination that people that live in that rim area around Boston, now they go here for a night out, even if it's not in the sporting season, or to go see entertainment and whatnot. So it's been a huge success, and they're really proud of it. They have signs around that say, it's reused water. So it's a triple bottom line. It was economic for everybody. It was social for the town. It was social for the region. And it was great for the environment, because this is at the headwaters of a pristine stream. And we knew we were protecting that stream, and we were protecting the aquifer that these people use as their water supply. And so we're reusing about 75% of the water here. The other 25% that's excess gets recharged into the groundwater underneath the parking lots. We have recharge beds under the parking lot. And it's been there since the year 2001. It's been expanded once. So it's a great example for us. And as we go forward now, urban redevelopment seems to be a thing that's catching. The cities are rebuilding. There's regrowth in the cities in America. So there's this turn of attention to, as you redevelop an area, you can't rebuild all the sewers in an old urban city sometimes. So what you do is you build these district scale systems. And kind of similar to what you have here at Dockside Green, maybe a slightly larger scale. And this is a picture of one we're working on now that's 5 high rises in Queens. And it'll be like, 100,000 gallons a day. It'll serve those 5 high rises. And it'll allow those high-rises to have less resource use from the water supply and less impact on the discharge to the sewers. And the discharge to the sewers is really important because most of the sewers in this area of New York are combined sewers, so they have overflow problems. So here they're allowing economic growth while they're having the growth, they're reducing the impact on their sewers. And that's a model that seems to be catching on in many cities. Those 13 cities, I listed in that first slide, those people are all participating in that non-potable water supply conversation because they know it's important to the future of their cities and managing their resources. It's a little bit about the technology and how it works from a kind of engineering schematic standpoint. So you saw Zach is the engineer that was on that video. Wastewater comes down into the basement. You have this feed tank. And it's interesting, as you design these systems, it's like designing a mini water supply system you would for a town, except your town's really small here. So you've got to have some resource on hand, so that's our water tank. And here's our reservoir of treated water. And so you have a reservoir on one end, and you have a supply on the other end. And as water gets reused, as people are flushing toilets or the cooling towers are calling for water, the level in the reservoir starts dropping, and the computer detects that instantly and says, okay, let's start making water, and it strives to keep that reservoir full. And we design that reservoir so that on a peak hours during the day, as you go through the diurnal flows, it gets drawn down some in the morning, gets drawn down again around dinner time, and it floats up and down according to the demand, and the demand is created by the people up in their apartments using the non-potable water. And this is the membrane bioreactor that sits in between. And as we've done this, I'm going to talk a little bit about thermal energy transfer, something else we didn't realize when we started. We were just reusing water. Well, we had another aha moment. When we did the first residential system in Battery Park City, it had just come online, it had just been operating for a little while, we get a phone call from the building manager. He says, something's wrong. I got a complaint from one of the tenants that her toilet's steaming. I said, uh-oh, steaming? I know. Who dumped something? It was the first reaction. What chemical is volatilizing in her toilet? So you rush out there, and lo and behold, this woman had taken her air conditioning and really cranked the temperature down, and it was on high. It was blowing cold air towards her toilet, and the water in the toilet was warm enough that this mist was coming off the toilet. And we all got a good chuckle out of it, and we said, you have a preheated toilet, it's okay. And she was fine with that. But it made us stop and think, well, how hot is this water, you know? And so we started measuring temperature profiles in our reservoir, and we came to learn it's always 75 degrees. Sometimes it gets up to around 80, but it's always 75 degrees. And now instead of just storing 20,000 gallons of water for reuse, I'm also storing 20,000 gallons of warm water, which serves as a thermal mass for energy capture. So we came up with this idea of putting heat pumps on this to transfer that energy from the warm water, low quality heat, into high quality heat. So as the water from the city's coming in to heat the hot water in the buildings, it goes through a heat exchanger and it's heated up by the wastewater. It's a beautiful model that's now impacting also how people are looking at this as not just a water conservation play, but it's also renewable energy. I'm gonna talk a little bit more about that in a minute. Another big thing that's helped us, when we started, we either had customers that were desperate, like SWIB was, because they had a piece of land, they had to do something, or we had some really adventurous green builder that wanted to just do good. And that's the dynamics. We were up here with the people who just wanted to do good and the people that were desperate. Well, because it wasn't an economic proposition in the beginning. There was no way when we started in the 80s and 90s that this would have been considered affordable by comparison to plugging into the water, the public water supply or public wastewater. But as time went on, our government stopped subsidizing water and wastewater like they used to in the beginning. And they, as time went on, the cities had to start spending actual dollars, dollar for dollar, in financing upgrades and repairs. And all across the country, water rates started escalating very quickly. And right around the year 2011, 2012, in New York, we crossed the point of $11 a thousand gallons, which was the target for us, that we knew we could produce reuse water at that mark. And then once they were above that, we knew we had an economic, solely economic proposition. And so now you can see there are many cities that are higher than that, San Francisco being one of the highest, and San Francisco being faced with the big drought. They're really excited to start developing a lot of decentralized water reuse, and they're one of the entities leading this charge to create these guidelines and this regulation. So this is just a picture about how it's kind of done, just so you get to see, you see how a building's built. We actually work with the architects, and we build these little wastewater treatment plants right into the foundation of the building. They give us low quality space, for sure. They're not going to give you the high quality space. And we design the concrete into the concrete foundations. We have to stage this over time so it's built as the building's being built, so it takes a bit of coordination with the other trades. We work with all the trades to create these, and they all really love it because they see it as more work for themselves. So the plumbers union and the iron workers really think this is great, fully support it. And you can see the range of cost here. It depends on the scale. And these buildings are about $100 to $150 million buildings, depending on the nature of the, how fancy the building is. And these, this component's about $1 million, typically. And that's expensive, because it's really small. And that's probably at around $45 a gallon per day, which in, converted to liters is about $12 a liter. As they get bigger, they get much more affordable. And as you start getting to the not even Gillette Stadium scale, you're down to the $16 a gallon per day, it's just $4 a liter, and you're starting to get close to costs that are considered affordable everywhere. So what we see happening is if we look at the New York City trend of where they are at with their rates and where they are headed with their rates, what they have a five-year look forward, and they've created a 25% incentive. New York and San Francisco both have incentives now. If you reuse water, New York City gives you a green rate, so they'll take 25% off your sewer and water bill. San Francisco has a capital grant they'll give you to build these to offset some of your capital costs. This is what your economic profile looks going forward with water reuse. So now we are clearly an economic value proposition to developers, that if you're a developer and you're going to own the building and you're going to own it for a long time, you're going to own a dinosaur if you don't have water reuse in it. So we're routinely now building water reuse systems in Manhattan. And if you had asked me 20 years ago if that was possible, I'd say you're out of your mind. But things have really changed that dramatically in this time frame. So just a little bit about the thermal energy capture. So this is our membrane bioreactor. It's my reservoir. I put this heat pump here. You know, I can get a lot of energy out of this heat, so much so that I, in theory, could recover 43 kilowatt hours per 1,000 gallons. And my treatment plant takes about 10 kilowatt hours per 1,000 gallons to treat. Well, you don't reach 100% efficiency. So as we've done this and we've built it and tested it, we get about 400 kilowatt hour out, and we're putting 350 in. So what it's done is it's established a framework by which we now can reuse water in a building, and it can be a net energy benefit to the building. As opposed to before, this was considered, one of the things that scared people is that this is going to be an energy hog. You know, doing it at this scale is going to consume too much energy. So you start thinking about all the dynamics, all the water that wasn't pumped to this building, or that sewage that wasn't pumped away from this building, and all that energy from that warm water that goes into that. And, you know, I hadn't thought of it before, so you may not think of it, but it's almost like heating your house and leaving the window open. Because here you're warming up all that water, but you're just throwing it out. When if you had a way of keeping it inside the building and containing it and using it, it has value. So in some areas, greenhouse gas reduction is really important. It's really important in California because they have goals in mind that they're striving for, that this not only now saves them on their water, it also really improves the greenhouse gas impacts of water management. So that's become another important point, and it's another value proposition. Not an economic proposition today, because energy is so cheap. You really don't get much savings from doing that financially, but you get a tremendous reduction in carbon footprint. And in some places, you get a savings because they're selling carbon credits now, so you get that savings. And someday, I believe energy prices will go back up some, so you'll be protected from that in the future. So just a little bit about this. There's other aspects of this. We also use anaerobic digestion and create biogas in wastewater plants. That's another way you can produce renewable energy from wastewater, by taking the solids, the carbon waste that's in the water, digesting it anaerobically and producing anaerobic gas, and then using that gas to turn it into usable energy, either through burning the gas or putting the gas in an engine, running an engine to create electricity. So this is a model in Ridgewood, New Jersey. We came into an existing wastewater plant that had two digesters, and we put in a combined heat and power system, which is basically taking the gas. We captured the gas. We upgraded the digesters so they would produce more energy. We redesigned them so they were optimized as energy producers, whereas they were designed originally by the engineers as a way to stabilize biosolids, and that was it. We redesigned them so that they're optimized for energy production. We set up a little waste receiving station so that people could bring the restaurant waste, the fats, oil, and greases, into the facility. Because we know fats, oil, and greases are really chock-a-block with calories, and that's what we want. We want food to go into the digester to create energy. And we put in this engine set that was a special engine with a special water jacket that took that water and warmed it up and used that heat to go back into heat the digesters. So that's considered combined heat and power. You're producing energy, electric. You're using electricity to power the plant. You're creating thermal energy, using that to warm your digesters. And you're bringing fat, soil, and greases in to feed that digester to make energy. Now, before we did this, most of that fat, soil, and greases went in pump trucks, and it went 100 miles away to Delaware. It was the only place we'd take fats. Fat, soil, and grease is really ugly stuff. No one wants it. And so when you can figure out a use for it, it becomes valuable, all of a sudden that changes. So now these trucks are driving 10 to 15 miles. So think of the carbon footprint of that. Think of the fact you're generating energy here from this. This treatment plant has reached the point where we can produce all the energy the treatment plant needs from the biogas, and from, we have some solar in here. We have a little solar field we put in as well. So that's another kind of interesting dynamic. And this kind of just shows savings that the town gets over the years for having done this in terms of energy conservation. They have this TV screen in their municipal building where everybody can go in and see how much renewable energy they're using. And it's really great. It's a really great model. This is a bigger example of that. That first one is only 240 kilowatts, relatively small. It's a 3 million gallon per day treatment plant. This is a big one. This is out in the Potawatomi Indian tribe out in Wisconsin. They have a casino, and they have a lot of food manufacturers. A Green Giant is out there, and they have a lot of vegetable processing and food processing. So taking all food waste from this region, and this is a 2 megawatt, they said it was 2 megawatt design facility that produces energy for the region. And we've actually reached the point where we've been able to produce 2 megawatts with just one of the digesters. So we think it's going to go way beyond 2 megawatts. So this is another application of that sort of integrated infrastructure from that perspective, applied to a different locality, different community, different dynamics. Here the water reuse wasn't important. The energy was. So this model, this picture here, we got this wonderful opportunity in Boston through the Charles River watershed. And if you've been to Boston, you're familiar with it. It's a wonderful city. And they had horrendous wastewater problems years ago, and they built this massive sewer system out on an island called Deer Island. And whereas it solved the problems in the bay, there's no more floating sludge in the bay like there used to be. It's an expensive system, and what they didn't realize, it drained a lot of the water from the aquifer, because now all that water that was staying on the island is going off the island. So they're challenged with that. And the Charles River Watershed is the environmental association that maintains those streams, and they want to bring that water back into the aquifer. And they've come up with an idea of going into the urban area and building these smart infrastructure trees. They call them quirks for community water and energy resource centers, to actually take the sewage out of the sewer, process it to meet the needs of the community, whatever that community would be. And here it's going to be a combination of institutions. They have a lot of colleges in Boston. Institutions, industries, and there's actually a fishing industry that wants to participate in this, to use the water and to use the thermal energy. So we would collect the wastewater, treat it, send non-potable back for processing and for heating and cooling, have a hydronic heating system to transfer energy from the wastewater hydronically and send hotter chilled water back into the building to be used there. and take the biosolids and use them for anaerobic digestion, take whatever source separated organics to build a small scale integrated system to produce renewable energy, reusable water, groundwater recharge. They don't want to just make the water for the consumption of the building. They will actually want to make sure they make a lot of it to put back into the ground and use recharge the groundwater, and eventually get into extracting nutrients. That's the next era we see we'll be moving to. Right now we're working on the energy in the water, but think the nutrients is going to be coming next. So as we're planning these, it's a really interesting exercise of understanding and modeling all the dynamics of the customer you're serving, what the resources are in terms of those wastes are now resources. What are those resources? How dependable are they? What are their characteristics? What's their flow? How do you make sure you have them? And then what does that turn into in terms of what demand for supply do they need for water, energy, thermal energy? And how do you divide that up? We model this. We have financial analysts that work with us. We model this out, understand the economics of it, and then decide how to build one of these systems wholly contained within a building. This is going to be in a commercial area to extract the sewage from the sewer, and you're going to turn that beast around. You're going to take that sewage out of the sewage and then use it as a resource. And it's not the only place where this is being contemplated, but this is certainly one of the more large-scale, aggressive ones that we've seen. They've identified the area that they want to put this in, and they are out right now raising funds. This can't be done with just private equity at this moment. It's just not enough certainty to it, so they're looking for gift money right now to help finance this, and they would like to do three of them. They'd like to do one in Boston, one on the West Coast, and one in the middle of the country as demonstrated models of truly integrated infrastructure for the urban areas. And you know, there's all sorts of ways of looking at this green infrastructure in terms of how we're turning that linear model around and how we extract value from it at all its various points. And it's just a wonderful model of what we can do in the future. You have to do it at the right scale, have to do it with confidence that you have the right technology and the right ability to make sure that that technology gets deployed and operated effectively. And all of these systems we've done as they call design, build, operate. So we take full responsibility for the performance. That's the only way we'll do it, because we've learned the hard way years ago that if somebody designs it and somebody else builds it and somebody else operates it, there's too much opportunity for finger pointing and not good in, you know, taking risk responsibility. So we only do it this way. And it allows us then to also, as we develop something, implement it so we can always optimize and improve as we go along, because it helps us then on our bottom line and our performance. So you set up a model where you're incentivized to always innovate. And the innovation always drives value for us, and it drives value ultimately for the customers and for the community. So some of the caveats, though, income projections are hard. This is a new world. We're playing now in areas that the dynamics of those resources and how they'll vary over time with what market influences they have aren't well understood yet. So that's definitely a valuable. It has to be built into the model. So you have to take modeled assumptions. The benefits, though, are numerous in terms of flood and drought resilience, greenhouse gas emissions, renewable energy. You're reducing the pollutants. You're really getting rid of those pollutants instead of using them as a dilution to dilute them into the environment. It enhances economic development because you now can turn your urban area that was probably constrained somehow by a resource, whether it was wastewater or waterside, and you can turn it into a much more vibrant community economically. You have catastrophic storm flexibility and adaptability, as I explained to you with the Superstorm Sandy, so you're protecting yourself. And actually, some hospitals are looking at this as a way to create safe zones. New Jersey's thinking about this too, so you create a district where within that district you have enough resource to be able to stand alone for 7 days without needing supply from outside. So now it gets into the exercise of, well, how do you do that? How do you store energy? How do you store the waste sources so that you could be self-sufficient? An idea came up about batteries. I'm sure Tesla would be happy to hear that we use batteries, but I don't think that's realistic at the moment. But you could compress gas, you could store food waste, you could have various things that would serve for that purpose. So that's an exciting opportunity that's moving forward. There's also this idea of the responsible management entity that, as you see these guidelines that are going to come out in California, it's the management description of what needs to happen. Because now you're moving beyond the traditional municipal model of one big system, one entity taking care of that one system. Many of these systems are on private property, or they're so distributed and decentralized that the core entity might not have the discipline, the skills to know how to operate them. So they said, well, how are we going to do this? So, well, we set up what's called a responsible management entity. Some entity with the proven financial and experience, financial viability and experience to know how to do it, signs up to take the responsibility for a long time term, like a public utility would. But this is just a public utility that has little assets as opposed to one big asset. And it's you organize them kind of like the other utilities, sort of like the cable companies or any other entity that you would screen for their viability of service. And you then have the responsible management entity coordinate what gets built, how it gets operated, takes care of customer service, and is fully responsible for compliance with the regulatory framework and posts the appropriate financial security to make sure that happens. So you've taken the kind of private utility model and you've squeezed it down into a small scale. And as we travel around, the market drivers for this vary. Like I know here in Victoria, the constraints and the opportunities are going to be very different than they are in California or Texas or New York. But what we see is right now, this urban rebirth is really big for us. Wherever there's inadequate or deteriorating infrastructure, provides a way to allow economic growth. This rapid increase in water and sewer rates with declining subsidies is a big aspect in our world. The security of supply issue is really big in California. That's, I'd say, the primary driver in California, although the greenhouse gas reduction is a secondary important driver for the people in California. And there are water quality concerns everywhere. You've probably heard Legionella issues in New York, lead issues in Flint, Michigan, and now in Chicago. All weigh into this, all that's happening around the world with all the chemicals we're making. Well, what we've been able to show is that by having systems that are contained close to the customer with the ability to optimize and innovate quickly, you've created a model by which you could address these things much more readily over time. Because we're not building one thing for everywhere for 50 years. Every system we do is a little more advanced than the last system we do. So you've created a model of infrastructure deployment that has the ability to continuously innovate itself, reinvent itself, and optimize. That's very different from what is the experience with the conventional approach. So in California, just again, this energy water nexus thing is big. Lowering your energy. California now, University of California did a study. They said that 20% of their electric power in the state is uses related to water. They had been saying it was 9 or 10% originally. Now they went out and they studied. They said, no, it's 20%. And so it's really important to them to take these new approaches going forward. And that in some of these models, particularly with the Legionella and other things, these decentralized approaches are actually providing better quality control at the customer's property so that you're able to control the dynamics of pathogens in a way where a long distribution system with miles and miles of pipe is going to be compromised by how long the residence time is for the disinfectant, what might happen along the course of that pipe's length. And that this is an easier method to deploy. You deploy it just in time, just as needed, where you've needed it, custom designed to fit that pocket, that customer, that neighborhood, that district, whatever it is. So it takes on a different dynamic that way. So these customer drivers are varying widely, but basically we're seeing triple bottom line benefits throughout. This delivery mechanism we think is important. It's design, build, operate, design, build, own, operate is really important so that there's one point of control and responsibility. And that for us, this operations is not just O&M. That's something that we really have moved past. I mean, you saw Zach drinking the water. I mean, our people really get engaged in every aspect of what we're doing. They get to know the customers and the buildings that we operate. And it's really kind of a stewardship issue. I'd call it infrastructure stewardship as opposed to operation and maintenance. It's not just following a manual. It's understanding what's going on biologically and nurturing the system along to figure out ways to make it better as we go forward. And so for me, it's time, I think, we shift our perspective. And I use this illustration of a tree. We have this linear picture in our mind of how things work, but I like to use a tree just because I think a tree makes a good example of a metabolic system that's integrated its infrastructure itself in terms of how it reuses its water and its nutrients and its carbon. And you know, not every tree is the same. Not every tree grows everywhere. It's every tree grows where it can, and it thrives according to the nature of its environment. And we really find that as an interesting, just way to look at these integrated infrastructure systems. They're not one size fits all. It's a mindset, and it's a way of practice that lets you look as though you're going to grow a tree. What tree am I going to plant here? What nutrients does it need? And what value will I get back from this tree over the course of its life? And how do I enhance that? And how do I care for it? And so I like that model as an example. And so that's what I had to share with you this evening. I hope I was not too boring. And thank you very much for your attention. So a hospital's waste is complicated by what goes out in the red bag waste and what's in the wastewater. We're not regulated yet with regards to like pharmaceutical byproducts and whatnot that are in the wastewater, but we're watching it and we're testing it. So we use advanced oxidation systems at the end of our treatment as a means of providing what we know our customers want: crystal clear water, odor-free water, and we know they're doing the best job of destroying whatever chemical compounds are in there. And the testing we did with the United States, it's called the Center for Disease Control, the CDC, came out and tested. They told us you're going beyond what you need to do. You don't need to do that. The UV disinfection is enough. We said, no, we like to sleep well at night, and we like to know that if the UV's off a little bit, we got the oxidation, if the oxidation's off a little bit. So someone's told, you know, there's redundancies in the systems to make sure you're always working right. And the tests we have, I have to say, are limited. But from what we have shown, we're destroying most of the pharmaceuticals and the personal care products. But I don't want to say from one test that that's proof. It's not. And I think that's going to be something in the future people are going to be looking at much more closely. I think he had heard of what we were doing and knew that we were expert in it and asked us to do a peer review of reports that others had done. So I looked at the information. And to know it adequately, I wanted to see the sites and understand a little bit more about the lay of the land. So I came up here to have a look. And so I toured around, and I saw the Colwood area mostly, and looked at some of the produced reports on the soils and the geology, looked at what I could see visibly from the escarpments and whatnot, what the geology looks like. So all I'm trying to say is I think you have the possibility of doing some of this here. The extent you would do it here, or exactly where you would do it, I'm not going to say I haven't studied it at all. And I know from the work that was done by others that I looked at, it looks like the economics that they've applied are consistent with the economics we apply. Okay, but there's a various number of reports I was given that showed work that was given to the CRD in terms of an evaluation of an alternative that utilized groundwater recharge for Colwood and Langford.
Yeah, I just kind of looked at it as kind of like here. We can tie into what you were just talking about.
Yeah, I just wanted to answer your question about who they was. They is Colwood. Colwood paid for a collection of reports to show that we could do tertiary treatment and groundwater recharge. And as Ed has pointed out, we're not there at absolute proof yet, but everything looks really good. And Ed was charged by Mr. Beadle, thank you, to peer review that work. Because obviously, you know, Colwood had one set of people do the work, and then it needs to be peer reviewed by somebody completely different to get some surety that it works. Well, I think I'm actually going to say that I don't remember the exact numbers, but we're talking of the order of 15%.
15% of
what it would cost us, in Colwood.
Any other new questions over here before I go back to this gentleman?
What do you do with the sludge? How much sludge do you have? Do you pipe it, you truck it, or where does it go?
It varies everywhere we are, depending on how the community is set up, how they're managing biosolids. In some cases, we manage it ourselves on site. And the one picture I showed you, it's anaerobic digestion. In many other cases, it's trucked to a facility that a community sets up to manage the biosolids from their community. And sometimes that's variable. Sometimes we have a choice. We can go wherever we want with it. So that idea started in the late 90s. There was a big issue in America, in the States, when they all of a sudden woke up and said, we're never going to get rid of all the septic systems. Right, we're going to have decentralized systems. There was this vision originally, I think, they thought everyone was going to be on sewers. That's when you go back to the Clean Water Act, that's what they were going to do. And eventually somebody saw reality and they decided they weren't going to do that. So what are we going to do with all these decentralized systems? So I was part of a team for years worked on how you manage decentralized systems, right down to individual home septic systems. And we came up with the concept back then of responsible management entities, because the sewage authorities and the water authorities weren't interested in doing it. And the health agencies wanted somebody to do it. So EPA picked up and adopted that term, responsible management entity, to just address somebody that was looking at decentralized systems and being responsible for their performance. And you know, that's the idea too. You don't build it to last for 50, to take care of everything for 50 years. You build it to take care of what you need now and in the near future. And as I say, by the time you go to expand it, I'm going to guarantee you technology is going to be improved by then. And you're probably going to be doing something better, because that's how fast things are starting to change. Really important not to have odor. We don't have any. Yeah, and I realized, because at first, when we first started, way, way back, we were worried, because sewage treatment plants tend to smell. And as we moved into this membrane bioreactor dynamic, a lot changes with the biology and with the configuration of the system. Never would have been able to do what we're doing inside buildings if it wasn't for this advancement of this technology. So what you learn by these advancements is that the reason sewage treatment plants smell is because something's wrong. They're either not getting enough air everywhere, and the biology is not thriving the way it should be thriving, and so you get what they call dead zones. And so you're producing sulfides, hydrogen sulfide gas and whatnot that creates the odors. These membrane bioreactors are so compact in terms, and they're so intense in terms of the way the biology operates and the way you aerate them, that we've just proven you don't have that issue. Every system we have, we still put in odor control systems. And for the most part, they're not turned off, but they're not needed because they're carbon filtration systems, and we've never had to replace the carbon. And these are in high quality, you know, built. I have lots of pictures. I don't want to keep you in here for hours. There's systems we have right next to clubhouses at resorts and all sorts of arrangements like that that wouldn't have been possible with the older style wastewater treatment, the traditional secondary treatment, because the risk of odors would be too high.
Thank you very much. It's been a very, very helpful and fertile presentation. A lot of the ideas are not ideas that have been much talked about by the authorities who are responsible for the wastewater systems here. So we might be forced to think of the concept of a pilot project or an example before the rest of the community gets comfortable with these newer concepts. So a question of timing is interesting. If the Colwood project, which you apparently here to look at, were to be given a green light tomorrow, how long would it take for the installation and operation of the kind of system that's being proposed for Colwood? Because it might be a model, it might be a prototype that would have some interest if it could be done reasonably promptly. Is that feasible? What timelines are probable?
Well, there's timelines and there's timelines. Our timeline, we've had situations where we have to deliver these really rapidly because somebody's economic viability is depending on it. So you have to believe, and when Kraft hired us to do the stadium, there was a deadline. And it was within, I think it was a year. These buildings in Manhattan that we do, they're all one-year projects. That and that's part of the benefit of the design build. As long as you're giving the architect adequate drawings to know how to put the tanks in the foundations, and then you're ordering your equipment, you're staging it, you know, it's a different delivery mechanism, and it can go that fast. But I understand in a public sector there's testing to be done of the aquifer, of the soils, there's permits that have to be obtained. I don't know what your time frame is for that. But once it was spelled out what you were going to build, it's about a year.
On behalf of everybody here, I'd like to thank you so much for your time and insight tonight.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your attention. Thanks. Oh, you know.